Honorable Chief Secretary of Odisha and my dear friend, we have worked together for many years. Honorable Minister, Honorable Secretaries of the State, dignitaries, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for inviting me here. It's a pleasure to be back here. I come here many times in the former years helping set up Infosys, and the state has always supported us in every which way, and every government has supported us, including the present one. We have met with the Chief Minister many times and has always been affectionate and supporting, helped us with Akshaya Patra, so we have very fond memories of Odisha. Today I want to present about India and how tech entrepreneurs will help create a $10 trillion economy. So, we know that in 1820, India-China made up 45% of the world GDP. And in 1820, the steam engine went off patent and the rise of Great Britain took place. Great Britain colonized India and robbed India outright. Utsa Patnaik, an economist in Columbia University in New York, wrote that the British took away $45 trillion of wealth from India from the time they came here as colonizers to the time they left in today's money at a nominal rate of interest. Now, this is an extraordinary loot of any country. So India is not a poor country. It's a rich country with poor people. We must remember that. And today, again, in 2020 and in the decade of 2020-2030, India-China again will make up about 35% of world GDP. Now, what is India? Let's see what is India. We have 1.37 billion people. We are only growing at 1.11% a year. Our fertility is about 2, and right now, the whole of the south has a fertility of about 1.8, West Bengal is 1.6, Punjab is 1.6. Odisha today has a fertility of 2. I gave a report on human capital to the Honorable Chief Minister yesterday, and there, in the age group of 18 to 23, over the last 7 years, the population in that group has been shrinking by 0.33% a year. By 0.33% a year. So you have reached population stability very, very fast. And that means India will face aging rather than a population explosion. And this fertility across all social groups, for example, the Jains have a fertility of only 1.2. The Jains may disappear by 2050. The Sikhs have a fertility of 1.6. The Muslims have a fertility of 2.5 in 2013-15. And the fertility for the Muslims came down from 3.25 to 2.5 because literacy went up by 30%. So in all social groups across India, we've seen fertility come down. And of course, longevity, women are going to live longer. Literacy is poor, 79%. China is about 97%. Our GDP is $2.7 trillion. We're the fifth largest economy in the world. We should not forget that. Per capita income is low, but we're the fifth largest. And in PPP, we're $11.4 trillion. $11.4 trillion, the third largest economy in the world, because our prices are very low. And as I show you data, India is pretty big. And of course, export imports have grown. Our major challenge fiscally is that 27% of government of India's revenue goes to pay interest, which is very high because the cost of government debt is about 7.5%. Now, how have we grown? In 1950, when we became free, Pandit Nehru, our first Prime Minister, wanted to make India a socialistic paradise. He did everything right except for one thing, he suppressed private capital. So between 1950 to 1980, India grew at 3.5%, population grew at 2.5%, but the world grew at 4.5% a year. Prasenjit Basu, an economist in Singapore, has written a book called Asia Reborn, in which he says the whole world GDP grew at 4.5%, but India grew at 3.5% because we suppressed private investment. From 1980 to 1990, we grew at 5.5%, and that was my generation's great hope when Rajiv Gandhi became Prime Minister. So in 1991, we came close to default to international obligation. We opened up. We gave economic freedom back to our people. And look at the growth, what happened. But in 1991 to 2019, we grew from 275 billion to 2.73 trillion, growing at 8.6% a year for 28 years in dollar terms. 8.6% a year every year for 28 years in dollar terms. And that is remarkable. The only country that's done better is China, which has grown from 1978 to 1991 at 9.9% a year. And of course, our foreign currency reserves have grown. We got a decent savings rate and investment rate, and that's pretty good. In the last many years, growth has been pretty okay, though we have come down. This year, growth will be about 5%. And growth is down this year for a very important reason, and I wish we had done things better. After the ILFS crisis, the liquidity in the market disappeared, starting with October, November, December of 2018, when we had the finance minister was not very well. And in January, February, March of 2019, we had the interim budget in February 1, and then we went for elections. After that, we had elections, till the new government was formed and gave us the budget, there was no liquidity in the market. Because 40% of the lending was by NBFCs, and NBFCs suffered from the ILFS crisis because the mutual funds stopped giving them money, they could not raise bonds, they didn't lend. That means auto sales came down, real estate sales came down, housing sales came down, and auto, construction and real estate are the major drivers of the economy. So because of that, growth rates have now come down. Now the finance minister and the government has pumped up the economy by forcing banks to lend. Hopefully, this quarter, that is January, February, March will be okay. We may be at 5.5, and maybe from April we could go back to 6%. Then the next year at 6.5%. Now you can see inflation coming down. In UPA 2, we had high inflation because government borrowing went up to 25 lakh crores. That's a time when we had the impact of the global financial crisis, there's pumping of money, but inflation was very high. Now in the last 5 years, inflation has come down. Now it has gone up because onion prices have gone up, vegetable prices have gone up. Onion prices have gone up by 250%. India is the only country in the world where interest rates depend on annual prices. Because our CPI has 46% for food. And the food is based upon the index constructed in 2011-12. And because of that, we find that whenever onion prices goes up, inflation goes up. Core inflation today, excluding this onion prices, is about 4.2%, still around the RBI band. Now, this is a chart which shows you that our inflation has come down, it's gone up, it'll come down again. Fiscal deficit has come down, and government borrowing is quite less. We see what happened this year. And then growth rates have gone up. And this is very encouraging because we need to have a low inflation regime to take India up. Now, we are 17 years behind China. Whenever we compare India's economy, we must compare that with China. And that's very essential because of a very important reason. China and India are the only $2 billion countries where the population is very high. There's no point comparing India with a small city like Singapore or a small country like Finland. Odisha is about 3.5 crore people, 35 million people. And Odisha is a big country in global terms. So if you want to compare a European country, you must compare with Odisha, because my state of Karnataka and the UK have similar population of 65 million people. So I think we must not compare them. So if you compare us with China, we're 17 years behind China. China opened up in 1978. And China has done one important thing, which I'll explain to you as we go along, which India did not do. But we can see China and grow up like China, maybe not as fast. Now, this is an important slide. Why are we having trade friction today? Why is Trump going after China? Why is there friction in the world? Because by 2028, the emerging markets will be bigger than the OECD. It last happened when Europe overtook Asia in 1820. Now it's happening again, where the emerging markets outside the European countries, that is Europe, Japan, and the United States, the GDP of the other countries will be higher by 2028. So global power is shifting toward the emerging markets, and the global architecture after the Second World War in terms of the Bretton Woods and the IMF and all the structures have to change. So there's a global shift in economic power, global shift in savings, global shift in investment, and this is creating trade tension because the United States is no longer the major driver as it used to be. Today, the US is only 17% of the world GDP and is shrinking, and Europe has been stagnant. And if you look at the future from 2020 to 2030, the US will grow at 2.3%, Europe 1.4%, Japan will be stagnant, rest of the OECD 2.3%,
China may grow at 6, India may grow at 8.8, others may grow.
The world will grow at 3.5. And IMF is very clear, the world will grow at 3.5. And this year, I think it will be less. But nevertheless, we see this kind of growth. This shift is going to cause turmoil globally in terms of world trade and all institutions for the next 10 years. This is an interesting chart. In Asia, we were the largest continent, most economically powerful continent for long, since the dawn of human civilization, because we had large population and we had an artisanal economy. Pliny the Elder wrote in Rome 2000 years ago that trade with India will impoverish Rome, because Rome bought our textiles and spices and gave us gold and silver. So the whole world came here. It is Soneki Chiria. Yes. And now we see it by 2010, 2030 is coming back and will be the dominant power once again. Now look at India and China. This is interesting. China is 1.43 billion people. We are 1.37. China is only growing at 0.35%. And the only state in India which is growing population 0.5% is Kerala. Between 2001 and 2011, Kerala only grew at 0.5% a year, the lowest growth among Indian states. And today I'm told 9% of Kerala speaks Hindi. So actually see Hindi signs in Kochi. The Biharis have come there in a big way, because for Biharis, Kerala is the new Dubai. They get 750 rupees per day for unskilled work and 1,250 rupees a day for skilled work. And they're marrying the Malayali girls too, because the men have gone away to Dubai to work at 45 degrees heat to earn some 30,000 rupees a month. And I think, by 2030, we could have 25% of the population of Kerala being Bihari. Whole villages are going there. You must go to Kochi and see that interesting experiment. So migration within the country is very, very, very different and is happening. And so growth rate in India is less. Chinese live longer. 96% literate. Now, why did India not grow the same as China? When Mao took over in 1949, he made a very important statement. Women hold up half of heaven. He educated China's women. Nehru did not educate Indian women. Indian women literacy has been very low. It's only the last 20 years that literacy has gone up. And now we produce a report called the Human Capital Report at FICCI. And there's some interesting conclusion. You'll be very happy to know that this year, the gross enrollment rate for Indian girls is higher than Indian boys. They've overtaken the boys this year. So in the decade of 20 to 30, we'll have more women in college, more women graduates coming out. India will be a better society. India produces 90 lakh graduates per year. 90 lakh graduates per year. And you'll be very surprised to know that India has 3.74 crore young people in college with a gross enrollment rate of 26.5%. And in the eastern part of India, Odisha has done very well, taking GER from 16% to 22%, higher than West Bengal between 2011 and 2018-19. Another interesting thing is happening in societal group, which is very interesting, is SC community is 16.6% of population as per 2011, 14.5% of students in college. ST is 8.6 and about 5.8. The OBC is 40% of population, but 36% of young people in college. The Muslims are 15%, only 5.2% of young people in college. This is the biggest problem we have, that the Muslims don't have enough of the young people in college. And I think this is something that has to happen. But between 2011-12 to 2018-19, Muslim women enrollment in college has been 7.8% a year, every year. Muslim boys are enrolling at 7.7%. So there's been a lot of increase in enrollment. Their participation is very low. So in human capital development too, I think we are catching up. We are not there, we'll catch up. But China's GDP is 14 trillion, we are 2.7 trillion. In 1978, we both had about $150 billion. So they opened up in 78 and they've gone far ahead. And this year they crossed per capita income of $10,000. We are just at $2,000. So China has become the largest economy in the world in PPP, overtaking America. And that's why Trump is fighting China. And then China is the largest exporter, largest importer, largest foreign currency reserve, largest debt in the world. Chinese debt is something very humongous at 250% of their GDP. So we can compare India with China
And we can see that we have a scope to go up there,
hopefully without the debt.
Now, this is an interesting slide. In the last 5 years, government has reduced subsidy to GDP from 2.43 to 1.86. So with the benefit of technology, government has been able to save money. 7.4 lakh crores has been transferred to beneficiaries by DBT, and about 1.42 lakh crores has been saved. $20 billion has been saved in terms of money that is getting lost. And India has now embarked upon the largest medical insurance program for 100 million families. 100 million families for about 50 million people, 500 million people, and that's remarkable.
But the good thing is, the data on this 500 million people is going to be on a portal. Using the data, you can run AI algorithms to find out how people's health can be improved. And this will be the largest single database of the human condition in the world. Now, this chart is important for all of us. We always think India is a poor country, India is a less developed country, and India is this and this. But look at this. Second largest producer of steel in the world. Second largest producer of cement, 502 million tons capacity, 380 million tons production. Two-wheelers largest, four-wheelers fifth largest, construction sixth largest, ITS fourth largest, electricity third largest, wireless phone second largest.
We're ahead of the United States, ahead of Europe, we're ahead of Japan, only China is ahead.
So we are pretty good, but the prices are low, so you don't see it in GDP.
And in terms of natural resources, 739 million tons of coal is mined here, and we are the second largest after China. China is about 2.2 billion tons of coal.
Of course, we consume about 900 million tons of coal.
Now, people often talk about pollution in Delhi. If you look at the satellite maps, there's a 3 kilometer layer of smog from Peshawar all the way to Calcutta. I was telling Gautam today morning that when I saw the out of the window, the sky was not blue. There was smog in Bhubaneswar. That's all because we burn 900 million tons of coal a year. 730 million tons is Indian coal, which has got an ash content of 35%. 230,000 megawatts of power is there in that particular belt, and all the smoke goes up and it sticks there. It's been there for the last 20 years. In summer it goes up, in the winter it comes down. It's not going to go away unless you change what is being burned there.
So iron ore, fourth largest, of course Odisha leads. You're going to make a lot of money through all these auctions. You'll be a very rich state. You are a rich state.
And aviation, seventh largest, railways, roadways, ports, every field of human activity, India is pretty large.
What about food grains? Second largest producer of food, 70 million tons in stock, 282 million tons. China is number one with 520.
Milk, largest producer, 176. Cotton, largest in the world. Horticulture, second largest after Brazil. And sugar, largest, the second largest. Spices, 2.8 largest.
Cropland, we are the largest cropland in the world, more than China, more than America. 50% is irrigated, but productivity is 50% of America and China. If you have the same kind of productivity and use more arable land, we can feed half the world.
So livestock, 510, they have full freedom and fundamental rights under the constitution, so they wander in the streets. But this shows that we are a major producer of most things in the culture. Now, we have a strong financial base. We have got more than 5,000 companies listed with $2.3 trillion. In the last 5 years, we've seen mutual funds increase to about 28 lakh crores.
So money has come up into the markets in a very big way in the last 5 years, led by technology. And we'll be the youngest country in the world by 2020. 29 years is the average age. Japan has got an average age of 48. When you become old, and we become a old society, there are different problems. Last calendar year, 2018, the Japanese produced 930,000 babies. 1.3 million Japanese died. 30% of Japan is above the age of 65. Japanese women live up to 88, men up to 85. They have an old age problem. The population of 124 billion will shrink to 97 million by 2050 and 67 million by 2100. 10% of Japanese land has no owner. Where the owner is dead, and their inheritors don't want the land because they got to pay duty.
So businesses are shutting down. The average age of a Japanese farmer is 65 years. Nobody wants to marry a farmer. It is a tough place. They're very rich, but you know, they're shrinking, they'll disappear. And that's what it is, because if you have an old age problem, Europe also has got a problem. They'll not be able to pay pension for the old people. So India is well-paced. China may become older before it becomes richer.
China too has got a problem. They're only producing 14 million babies. India produces 25 million babies every year for the last 30 years. And now I think another 2-3 years, the number of babies they produce is going to come down slowly as people have lesser babies.
So even by 2100, we'll have a good young population. 59% will be in the working age of 15 to 64.
So we don't have a problem of an aging population. Today, the problem is not of an expanding population. The world faces the problem of aging, except for Africa and the Middle East. Rest of the world has a problem of aging. We'll not face it till 2100.
And we have a huge human capital infrastructure, 973 universities, 51,000 colleges, 3.74 crore young people in college, going up to 26.5% in GER. But by 2030, FICCI says that we'll have about 7 crore young people in college. We'll graduate 1.8 crore people every year. So I think it'll be a very different kind of scenario as we go along in the future. So we have our savings rate of 32%. Investment rate 32%, savings are 30%, consumption has come down, again is gone up. This is still 2017-18, you must see new data. Of course, this year is a bad year.
So we have enough savings, except that we don't have enough financial savings. Our household savings is only 11% of GDP. The private sector saves about 7%. So the government borrows about 8 to 9%. The fiscal deficit of the state and the union, plus the public sector, they borrow money. We don't have enough money. In fact, the Prime Minister had called a meeting of industry. I had gone there and he asked me, what do you have to say? I said, first, you have to talk to people and improve the mood. The mood is very bad in industry. Please talk. He said, I'm doing that. Then I said, to reach $5 trillion, there's not enough money. Government of India should go borrow $500 billion in 30-year loans from Japan or somewhere so they get the money into India and not borrow within India. If we don't borrow within India, there'll be enough financial capital, companies will get money and investment will go up. We just don't have enough money within this country through our own savings to go up to 5 trillion. Now, GDP by sector. Today, 16% of our GDP is coming from agriculture, industry is 30%, but look at China, only 7% in agriculture, 41% in industry and 52% in services. China has become the factory of the world and that's where they're producing the majority of jobs. Now, what are India's challenges? Before I come on to tech, India's challenge is this. 43% of our people depend on the land and land produces only 16% of GDP today. 57% of our people depend on industry and services, which is growing at about 78%. And agriculture is only growing at 2.83% a year. So people on agriculture, people on the land will never have enough money to make a good living. Whatever subsidy you give, they will never have enough money. Average land is about 2-2.5 acres and is coming down. And in the last 15 years, this number of people on the land was 60%, it's come down to 43%. We have to bring it down to 20% to make sure that people have a good living. This is the basic fundamental challenge. People on the land have a per capita income of 42,000 rupees and people on factories are 1,25,000 and services 1,64,000. This is a basic challenge. Too many people on the land. Now people say, people come off, will we grow enough food? America grows enough food for 350 million people with just 300,000 farmers. China grows double our food with only 9% of population being in agriculture. So I think there are too many people on the land, they have to come off. So what is the solution? The second problem we have is our rate of urbanization is 34%. Urbanization is very low. The world is 52%, China is 59%. Urbanization is required because urbanization is concentration of human activity. Concentration of human activity creates specialization. Specialization increases productivity. Increased productivity leads to increased wages. But does it mean that everybody should come to Mumbai, Delhi or Bangalore? No. We should create 5,000, 6,000 small cities. Invest in those cities. So people from the villages will go to the smaller cities and we must have labor intensive industries. Bangladesh exports $45 billion of garments. India only exports $26 billion. And about 10 years back, I think Bangladesh was only about 10 billion India was about 16 billion. And Bangladesh is able to do it because they have good policies. So we need labor-intensive industry to soak up the excess labor coming off the farm, but in smaller cities. So we have to develop smaller cities. I hope Odisha will have a program or urbanize the smaller cities to make sure that population shifts, where you can give them good education, good health, good facilities in those cities. Because the world is also changed and we are lagging behind. And then, of course, you can see the number of people coming in the workforce. What about jobs? Now, 25 million babies are born every year. For the last 30 years, they will come into the workforce, attain the age of 21 every year. We made a study about the number of jobs. About 15 million of the 25 million want jobs, because the 40% possibly get married or, you know, don't get jobs or don't want to work. Out of the 15 million, we're able to track 11 million jobs that are being created in the professional sector, in the sector which is done by the Ghosh and Ghosh report for in the PF sector and in the transportation sector. So we see this kind of job creation. About 4 million jobs are not there. So India's problem is not that jobs are not being created, but jobs do not pay enough. Out of 11 million, only 2.5 million jobs pay well. Well means 45,000-50,000 rupees a month. The rest do not pay well, the low paying jobs. Second, there are more graduates in North India than jobs. The jobs are in South India, the graduates are more in North India. UP graduates 15 lakh graduates every year, but there are no 15 lakh jobs there. And today, more women are graduating in North India and all over, and women do not migrate. From the North to the South, they migrate for jobs. The men migrate, women stay back, and that's why women participation in the workforce has come down. Because more women are in school, more women are in college, and after graduation, they don't get a job. Because they're in UP, they're in Rajasthan, they're in Madhya Pradesh, not Bihar. Even Orissa is producing a lot of women graduates, but they will not leave the state because, you know, the men may leave and go outside to create jobs. And if you look at Provident Fund data, most of the jobs are in Karnataka, Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu, and Telangana. And this is an interesting slide. All states in this country and the union government have done something interesting over the last 5 years. They have worked very hard to give their citizens the necessities of life. A roof for the house, water in the tap, power in the switch, food on the table, education for the children, an internet connection, a mobile connection, a bank account, a gas stove in the house, healthcare to everybody. This has been given. By 2022, most people will have houses. Odisha stands out. We have done very, very well in this. So we have given the people the necessities of life. We have given the people everything to keep body and soul together and to lead a dignified life. We give them food too. We give them subsidies. We give them money in the bank account. That is why the decade of the 2020-2080 requires a different strategy. We need a different strategy based on the digital economy to provide high quality jobs, invest in human capital. That's why all states have to think and change and create a new vision. And this, I think, tells you that we have solved many of the problems that were there earlier tremendously in the last 5 years. So the next 5 years have to be totally different to prepare for the future, or it'll be lost. Now, startup ecosystem. And this startup ecosystem will help India become a $10 trillion economy by 2030. Look at this chart. This is transform. World has changed. There's a digital world that's being created. There are 7.7 million people on the planet. 5.1 million have a unique mobile phone. 4.3 billion have a internet. And social media is 3.5 billion. So more people on the mobile, more people on the in the internet than ever before. The world has changed. Everything has changed. And the world is not going to be the same again. What about India? We have 1.2 billion mobile connections, 900 million unique users, almost everybody has got it, 560 million internet users, and active social media 310 million. We have 400 million people on WhatsApp. And that's why today communication is by WhatsApp, communication is by Twitter and Facebook. Everybody is talking. And for the last calendar year, TV sales fell down for the first time ever. Because more people are seeing video on the phone than watching TV at home. So all those TV channels telling us about what is happening in various places, they're going to lose their business. Arnab Goswami may do well. We have a small investment there too, but he'll do well because he's got some magic. But you know, rest of them are in trouble because of this change. But this has repercussions on every facet of activity. How does government communicate with citizens? How does government provide governance? How does government provide health, the delivery of health, the delivery of education, entertainment, jobs, commerce? Everything will be digital, and you can see the sea change that has happened. So India is the third largest ecosystem of startups in the world. Today we have 45,000 startups who created $150 billion of value. 45,000 startups, $150 billion of value. And then we got $60 billion coming in since 2014. This one-year-old data, the data came out just last week, $60 billion has come in. But only 10% is Indian. So we could become a digital colony because the best companies are all owned by foreigners. We are 34 unicorns. Unicorns are billion-dollar enterprises. And 50% of all active startups are in Bangalore, Mumbai, and Delhi. And here is where Odisha should look at its strategy. Odisha has an opportunity to become the best state in the east of India in the digital world. Odisha requires to go away from natural resources to go on to the digital world and create new kinds of jobs, new kind of entrepreneurship, new business models have to come up. And Odisha has to modernize rapidly in this particular area. In Bangalore today, we have a population of 1.2 crores. There are 20 lakh jobs in the digital world, in technology. 20 lakh people are employed in technology. Bangalore this year will export 3,50,000 crores of software. 3,50,000 crores. And Bangalore is 60% of Karnataka's GDP. It's got a per capita income of $10,000 per head, the highest in India. Highest consumer loans in India. It pays the second highest quantum of individual taxes in India. And the biggest industry is the IT industry. So, but IT industry produces high quality jobs, and you can see all these huge things that are happening. And this is an interesting slide, what is happening. India has a world-class industry, the software industry. This year, 2020 March, India will export $150 billion of software, the largest exporter of software services in the world. The $150 billion is the market value of $200 billion because the prices are low. The world makes $600 billion of software, one-third from India. The total market is $1.2 trillion. $600 billion is the software products which are resellable. We have 4.5 million people employed in this industry. And the United States has 6 billion people in software. Out of this 4.5 million, 2 million work for American companies. Out of 8 million working for American companies, 3 million are Indian. In the Silicon Valley, 25% of startups have an India founder. 35% of cybersecurity startups have an India founder. And among the top 10 software service companies in the world by market value, 5 are Indian. Of the top 5, 3 are Indian. TCS is number 2 with about $120 billion of market value. Accenture is number 1 with about 127. Of the 2 million employees in the top 10 in the world, 1.5 million are Indians. So we clearly dominate. And because of this domination, we have a very vibrant startup industry where many people leave and start companies, including fresh graduates in college. So if you come to Bangalore, you can set up a company and hire 1,000 people in any technology within 6 months. So you've got a critical mass has to be created, and that's benefiting. So by 2025, the startup industry in India will have 100,000 startups employing 3.25 million people. Today they employ 750,000 people, creating $500 billion of value and 100 unicorns. Unicorns are billion-dollar enterprises. You know, there's a company called Baiju. Have you people heard about it? Okay. We gave the first check to Baiju in 2012. We gave $9 million at $20 million pre. Just 2 weeks ago, he raised $200 million at $8.8 billion. $8 billion pre-money. And Baiju is today worth $4.5 billion. He's a billionaire. $4.5 billion in 7 years. Unbelievable wealth is being created. And all of this is being created in technology and startup by this fast growth. Look at that list. On the right-hand side is all the startups who are unicorns. On the left are sunicorns, companies that could become unicorns in the next 2 years. So India has about 34 unicorns who have created $80 billion of value. There will be 100 unicorns by 2025. And this year alone, we'll have maybe 5 to 6 more unicorns being born. There's a tremendous change that is happening all across India. But the impact of the change is being felt in Bangalore, in Noida, Gurgaon, Delhi, and in Mumbai. It has to be felt in eastern India. Bangalore has more Oriya software engineers than Orissa. Bangalore has 150,000 Bengali software engineers. Calcutta has much less. So the best talent is going out. So you have to create an ecosystem here and do it. The state of Rajasthan has done tremendous work here. There's a remarkable IT officer, IAS officer called Akhil Arora. He was the IT secretary to Vasundhara Raje. He started in the first year of Vasundhara Raje's regime in 2014. And in 4 years, he made Rajasthan the best digital state. And Vasundhara Raje became the most digital chief minister of India. She was very pleasantly surprised when she got the award and told us, because we used to work with her and we worked with her, and she's very happy. She said, I've become the digital secretary. I went to my state, Karnataka, and told my chief minister, look, she has won the award and you must call her and tell you what she did. And he said, yeah, call her. And I said, you must call Akhil Arora. He said, yeah, call her. We want to learn. My state, which is the best in India. So political leadership engagement and the official engagement by stability can transform the state in 5 years. And that's what I propose to all of you in e-governance, in setting up e-health, in let us say e-revenues, in policing, in crime detection, in education, in every facet. He has done it and he has got software. And I was telling secretary that he employs 8,000 people. He signed off to give him unlimited number of jobs. He's got his own army of 8,000 people. So you can call him and take all his software products and use it here automatically and build on top of that, so you don't have to go through the pain of creating all that. So I think it works. So we are seeing this kind of change in India. And this is happening in enterprise software, all faster software. If somebody comes and tells you, oh, India is behind in technology, don't believe that. We're only 2 years behind Silicon Valley because we don't do enough research in the universities. We don't have any publicly funded research. And that's why 2 years before, in areas like artificial intelligence, machine learning, 3D printing, IoT, most of the companies in the valley have the back-end engineering in Bangalore. So if you look at all the areas, companies are coming up. These are all the companies that are there. They're small companies, but they're growing up. And in the deep technology like drones, virtual reality, wearable technology, IoT, 3D printing, smartphone, electric vehicles, etc., there are lots of companies coming up. There are some of the companies doing very well. Aether is a company like Tesla. They designed a two-wheeler motorcycle from scratch in 3 years, and they're selling very well. And these are the venture capital funds. Aarin is still there. We didn't write that. Somebody wrote it. And corporate venture capitalists are coming and investing in India. 17 and 18, there's been tremendous growth all around the world. So this is the amount of money that's coming from the corporate sector around the world, globally. And you see those big companies like Alibaba, Tencent, and other companies, like SoftBank, etc., coming here and investing. And if you look at this chart of digital companies, you'll find that in the world of digital technology, the United States and China dominate. But China is spending $65 billion every year, 60% from China. The United States invests $135 billion. Last year, India invested only $14 billion, out of which only $1.5 billion came from Indian capital. The rest came from foreign sources. So this is the way the companies are going in the world. And what is happening now is the internet-driven companies are creating their own system. If you take China, Alibaba is creating his own system where entertainment, dining, healthcare, news, transportation, everything, market consumption, everything is there based on Alibaba's investee companies. Tencent is creating his own system. So Flipkart is creating his own system in India. Amazon is creating his own system in India. Jio is creating his own system in India. We're coming to an ecosystem where you have to be part of the network. If you're not part of the network, you lose out in the marketplace. And they're becoming self-contained networks. This is one big issue that is happening around the world and India too. So what is the future of startups be? Everybody in India are digitizing. People at the bottom of the pyramid, people everywhere. Ravi Shankar Prasad is very fond of giving the example of this 80-year-old woman in a remote Andhra village. When he met her, she told him, I am also digital. He said, how are you digital? Oh, minister, I talk to my grandson in Dubai on FaceTime every day. Just imagine 80-year-old woman in a remote village, not literate, not educated, just press a button and talks to her grandson in Dubai by video. It's remarkable. That's the empowerment people have. Today, every individual with a phone is empowered. Indians consume 11 GB of data. I'll give you all the data. Now, one of the remarkable things that's happened in India is India Stack. India Stack was created by volunteers in Bangalore. It has four layers: consent, cashless, paperless, and businessless. It's like Linux. Linux is open source software, free to use. So this is also free to use, given to everybody. And that's why we've got Aadhaar. Aadhaar, 1.2 billion people. We got a eKYC, e-digital locker. We got UPI, 1.2 billion transaction. And we got open data store. And this has led to the jam trinity of Jandan, Aadhaar, and mobile. And you can see that individuals coming together, creating this for a public cause, can really bring about dramatic change. And this India Stack is India's gift to the world. About 24 countries are trying to get this from India and use it for themselves. And it's taken 10 years, starting from 2010, to come up to this stage. And look at all the changes that have come. Since we are all party to the change, we don't understand it. Aadhaar, eKYC, eSign, Mudra, Jandan, Payment Bank, UPI, IBC, eKYC. There's been so many changes that industry is shell-shocked. Too many changes. They can't cope with it anymore. And that's why many of them are giving up. But look at these changes. India is transformed radically. Now, there's rapid formalization, digitization in India, demonetization, digital India campaign. 12 million people are registered for GST and about 6.7 million file every month. This is remarkable. About 1.2 billion UPI transactions took place last month, and there's been a 95% reduction in mobile data costs. That is unbelievable today. 95% reduction in cost on the mobile after the coming of Jio. Now, India's new business backbone is based upon the Aadhaar, monthly UPI transaction, the Jandan bank account, the India Stack and GST and Digital India. This is what is the backbone on which business is getting built. So world-class products are being created in India Stack. India Stack is free to use. So every young person can come, download it, use it, and build a company on top. So many, many companies are being built up all over India. And what has been the help? The impact of the India Stack? To open a bank account, time has come down from 6 days to 1 hour. To get a mutual fund account, 4 hours to 2 minutes. And to get a SIM card, the asset managers, 1 day to 4 minutes for getting a SIM card. So India has got about 500 million smartphones. Last quarter, we bought 46 million smartphones. The total smartphone market in India is 2,50,000 crores. India has become an exporter of the mobile today. We are exporting this year $6 billion. Remarkable what has happened in 3 years. And by 2022, we'll be 900 million smartphones. This remarkable change. And this is augmented by leap in data. Data generation has gone up tenfold, exponential increase in access. Every Indian consumes 11 GB of data on an average. 11 GB of data. Americans consume 2.85 GB per month. America is very backward. 11 GB is unbelievable. And then storage, cloud storage cost has come down. Earlier you want to store your data, you need a data center. Now you can store it on the cloud somewhere within India or outside at a very, very low cost. And that is how this mighty leap come up. And this transformation is very, 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 very high. And we can get unlimited data for 100 rupees a month, $1.50. Americans have to pay $80. So India is going from data poor to data rich. We're halfway there because of social, commerce, payment, identity, etc. And when we get data rich, we have large databases. We can run AI algorithms. We can run machine learning. Now, AI can run with the large data sets, when there's large computing power and low cost. So computing power has gone up, low cost has come in, and we got huge amounts of data that is coming in. So India will be a fortunate country where AI can be run in a very, very big way. Then you can train the machines to do many things. So new age platforms are digitizing the ecosystem. So all around the country, there are platforms coming up, products, etc. In Bangalore, there is a agri-tech startup called Ninja Cart. What they do is, they go to the farmer and they tell him that, look, we want this kind of a product tomorrow. And they teach him how to grade, how to store. And then they go to their buyer and connect them so that every day they can go to the farmer, pick up in the morning, deliver to retail, and pay the money in the evening. The farmer's income has doubled. The farmer's certainty has gone up. Productivity is going up. Because today for farmers, the biggest issue is how to connect to market. And startups have come in to connect farmers to market. And that's remarkable. They're working with the FPOs all around India too.
And here you can see Jio has transformed India. On the web, T-Series has got more viewers than PewDiePie. And we see Savan, the music portal, come up. And Indians are seeing 67 minutes of video. Indians are not generous with the money, but generous with the time. They're seeing a lot of video. Don't ask me what this video is. I don't want to talk about it, but they're watching video. And 11 GB of data, which is being watched. And in Rajasthan, Vasundhara Raja gave away 1 crore smartphones to women. She hired 35,000 young students, made them e-sakis and trained them before the election. Our voting share went up after that, but it's a bit too late for her to come back. Baiju. Baiju has gone up from 68 million revenues to 432 million. He's got 35 million registered subscribers. 3.5 crore. All in 5 years. And this is the kind of teaching app it is there. The world's largest education tech company, the most valuable education tech company in the world, coming out of Bangalore. Ola Cars is competing with Uber. 1 million drivers, 450,000 cars. They've given jobs to 450,000 people with only 8,000 employees. Swiggy, 50 million deliveries a day, 50 million data points all over the country. They raised $3 billion. $3 billion. Billion dollars is 27,000 crores, 21,000 crores. Flipkart raised 50,000 crores. OYO raised 22,000 crores. Rashid, it's unbelievable numbers. 50,000 crores. Nobody has raised 50,000 crores. They raised 50,000 crores. They lost 35,000 crores. 35,000 crore loss. Even Vijay Mallya could not make that kind of loss. In saying, you poor man, you have to go away. But you know, they lost 35,000 crores. OYO Rooms, the world's largest, you know, new age company in the hotel area. They'll probably have more rooms than the best chain in the world. And here you can see in medical science, Situbal, it takes, you know, blood smears, urine, etc., and digitizes your human condition. So it takes a blood dot, you know, digitizes it, puts it in the cloud and gives you a pathological report in 10 minutes. They know what exactly is there because of technology. Bugworks. There is a kind of bug in the world called the superbug. It's a bacteria for which there's no cure. 1.5 million people die. You get it in the, you know, in the hospitals in the operation theater, and 1.5 million people die because the last big antibiotic was discovered in Tokyo 35 years ago. But this company in Bangalore, through biocomputing, has discovered a cure for 843 bacteria, which are part of the superbugs. They got $6.5 million of grant from Carbex. And Better Place. Better Place is a remarkable thing. Maybe you should call them. They have 7.5 million blue-collar profiles on their platform. They connect 200,000 people and get them jobs every month. So they become the world's largest blue-collar platform, and they're in Bangalore. Open is a newer bank. There are two kinds of newer bank. A newer bank lends digitally, or is a bank which provides services. Now, Open is getting 40,000 SMEs to come on the platform every single month. They got 300,000 SMEs in just 7 months. In just nine months. And they've grown rapidly just because of tech. There's an app on top of a bank account for MSME to do business. Clean mobility. You can see this Yulu in Bangalore, which has got electric cycles. And they've created this map of Bangalore using machine learning, where they can see all the spots where there's traffic congestion. So you can get down from the metro or the bus and take this two-wheeler and go to a particular place and park it. So they're creating a last-mile mobility solution. Ether is a motorcycle company which is creating a motorcycle based on software, ground up. Create without fiction. More than 100 fintech companies have come up. So you can go there, give your Aadhaar number and your thumbprint, and within 30 minutes, they'll find out your data and give you a credit score and give you money in the bank. This is mostly started by engineers, the cool app, but being engineers, they didn't know that when you lend money, you got to get it back. Half of them have lost their money.
A robust foundation to enable innovative solutions is being set. Because the government policy, India Stack, and everything else. So hundreds of experiments, thousands of solutions, thousands of young people working to change India forever. So India is optimizing to empower problem solvers.
So these young people are targeting our hard problems. What is the hard problem? Creating one single national market.
GST is there. We have supply chain cost of 14% of GDP, should go down to 6%. China is 6, America is 5. And then we must connect farmers and we must connect producers to consumers. We must give them access to good health, good education, everything on the mobile. And these are the young people who are creating this kind of solutions to do that. Reduce waste, reduce, increase the velocity of business, reduce the barriers to business, and make sure that everybody gets connected.
So India is empowering young people. Startups will be the force multiplier to catapult the country into $10 trillion economy by 2030.
And I think Odisha should have a digital vision, create a policy which where it has place for startups, it has place for e-governance, it has place for incubators, developing human capital all across, create a fund for agri startups, create a fund for medical startups to come, connect people to medical service providers and farmers to markets, solve the hard problem that exists through young people who don't know they can fail. Because young people are always wanting solutions. They're not old enough to know they can fail. With their enormous energy and passion, you must give the young Oriya a chance to dream, create a unicorn, and grow up. And that's what is exciting. And that's why I said I came here to talk to you. Thank you very much.